The more that I love him, the more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Since I started for the kingdom,
since
my life he controls,
since I gave my heart to Jesus,
the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. Come on, everybody. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven.
My heart overflows.
The longer I serve him,
the sweeter he grows.
Every need he is supplying. Persuaded that he is able. Come on, let us put our hands together as we sing this one.
Yeah.
fill my cup, Lord. Come on, anybody need God to fill their cup tonight? Come on, anybody need God to fill their cup tonight? Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy. And then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from the well that never shall run dry. Come on, everybody. Like the woman at the well.
Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy.
But then. Until some deed of greatness you may do to shed your light afar. Do not wait.
Do not wait until some deed of greatness you may do. Do not wait to shed your light afar. Though the many duties ever there you now be.
Come on,
brighten the corner.
Come on, everybody, brighten.
Let not talents, you may surely find a need. Every flame, the bright and morning star, even from your humble hand, the bread of life may
come on, brighten.
Brighten the corner where you
brighten.
Brighten the corner.
Shine for Jesus.
Brighten the corner where you are.
Someone
far from where you may guide across the bar.
Brighten one more time. Brighten the corner. Brighten. See Jesus in you. Can the world see Jesus in me? Do we live so close?
Do we live so close to the Lord today, passing to and fro on life's busy
way,
that the world in us can align mercy
to the man of Calvary. Come on,
can the world see Jesus in me?
Can the world see Jesus in you?
Does your love to him ring true and your life and service too?
Everybody, come on, good night, everybody. God is good, and all the time, God is indeed good. I want to welcome you to our first night of part two of the Homes of Hope and Healing evangelistic series. Amen. Can you imagine that between Megafest and Home of Hope and Healing, 3 weeks have already gone by? 3 whole weeks, and we have 2 more weeks to go, and we have been going strong. We've been seeing individuals giving their life fully to God. Amen? Amen? Individuals are surrendering their life to God. I want to tell you something. Yesterday, we had 26 persons baptized. Amen. Come on, I thought I would have heard an amen for that. And during the Youth Mega Fest, we had 18. Come on, somebody say amen, man. And we anticipate that more individuals will surrender their life for the next upcoming 2 weeks. And so we want to welcome those into the family of God who would have given their life to God. If you are here tonight and you've been baptized, you were baptized yesterday, I just want you to stand at this time. Just stand, I see you. Just stand, Even at the Youth Mega Fest, if at the Youth Mega Fest you were baptized, stand up, You see them, we see them. Give them a round of applause. We want to welcome you into the family of God. May God continue to richly bless you as you're now into the Seventh-day Adventist family. We love you. You can be seated. We love you. We appreciate you. And we are going to be there for you in your growth. Amen, members. We're going to be there for them as they are now entering this new relationship with God. So welcome one. Welcome all. Welcome to our regular members, to our visiting individuals. The president will have a special welcome for you when he comes up. But I just want to welcome you and let you feel special tonight in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Allow me to give one announcement. All the AY leaders throughout the zone, that is from Dubla right down to Grand Bay, all the AY leaders, right after the offering is collected, we just want to invite you to come to the back tent so that we can have a brief meeting with you to give you a few updates. Please meet with Pastor Sean Shepherd. He will give you some information. All AY leaders across the zone, please meet at the back tent behind the blue and white tent, so that Pastor Shepherd can give you some very important information going forward. Welcome one, welcome all again. God bless you.
Good evening, church. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and Throne. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, comforter, keeper, spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts are hopelessly lost away. Oh, we've hopelessly lost away. You are the one that we press. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. So hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in a weakness you find us, fallen before your throne. Oh, we've fallen before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. Oh, you give the healing and grace. Always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Oh, hearts always hunger for. Oh, always hunger for.
Good night, brethren. Okay, tonight is time to give your gift to the Lord. You know, this is costly, and we are talking about another bus. So this evening, as you give, we want soft. No coin. Get a note. Put your hand in your pocket and get a note and give to the Lord. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father in heaven, we are grateful for the opportunity you have given us to share in your work. We pray that as we give, you will bless our gift and may it go to the cause that it is set for. We pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So give and let the Lord bless you.
Come on, everybody. I need a blessing.
I need a blessing. I need a blessing. I need a blessing.
Everybody. Was that everybody? I got distracted there by my telephone, you know. I'm in the pulpit and the phone is like ringing or something like that. So let me do what is necessary, turn it off or down to make sure that that doesn't happen again. All right, so let's try again. Good night, everybody. Oh, yes, that's me. That's me. I want to take some time tonight to talk about a few things, and Pastor Morancy is going to be coming on. Praise team, maybe you can take five and then we can call you back. We don't want you to stand the whole time and so on. So during the course of the last 3 weeks, several new persons have been baptized and have become members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I know Pastor Tittle asked you to do it earlier on, but can I ask again, please? Can you stand so that everybody can see you? Maybe you weren't here when the invitation was given earlier. But could you stand one more time, please, wherever you are? You were baptized recently. Give them a big round of applause, everybody. Give them a big round of applause. Yes. Yes, there they are. Thank you very much. And one person walked up to me and said, Pastor Hall, they identified themselves by name and told me that they were recently baptized. And they wanted a photograph with me. Now, I am not accustomed to people asking to take photographs with me. You know, I know they do that with celebrity types, but not me. So I felt very special this evening when the young lady stopped by and said, Pastor, can I take a photograph with you? I felt a little bit elevated, you know, a little bit appreciated. And it made me feel good to be associated with you, my dear. May God bless you as you continue to walk with Jesus. The second thing I want to say is, this coming Sabbath day, we will have another large Bible seminar under the tent. We begin at 9 a.m. sharp, and we run until about maybe 12:30, the Sabbath school part and the divine hour part, and then we're going to have another baptism. Some people have been saying to me and to all pastors and Bible workers, I wasn't quite ready last Sabbath. I had some things to think about, some things to work through, some things to do. And I will be ready this coming Sabbath day. So put your hands together for those who have already said that this coming Sabbath, they will join others in baptism. I want to mention tonight that the long-expected bride. Amen, amen for what? Susanna is here. And perhaps if it's your first time, you may not be aware as to what that means. But my wife's name is Susanna. She is a school teacher in Barbados, and the school term had not ended until Friday, so she could not be with me. But she arrived safely today, and I am so glad that she is here. I told her that I will not ask her to come up on the platform. But I know people want to see who Susanna is, right? This group over here know her. You've seen her before. But maybe you're like me. You just like to see her all the time. So, come, let me come down and meet you and you can walk around so that everybody can see Susanna Hall. I've passed this speaker many times and the microphone never fed back like that before. What's going on tonight, Sean? Something is different. For all those, let's come in the light a little bit. So this is Susanna Ogis Hall. My wife is St. Lucian born, but has been living with me for the last 30 years. She's a woman that can put up with a lot. I must confess, you know, to live with me for 30 years has to be a challenge, right, Pastor Tittle? Pastor Tittle, what's going on over here tonight? You know? Right, so on April 25, a few days from now, we will celebrate 31 years of marriage. So it's great to have her in town and have her around for the next few days before she has to get back to Barbados to start school. She's on holiday, so enjoy your vacation, my dear. God bless you. So everybody saw the preacher's wife. Pastor Tittle, she's been telling me, why am I so hard on you, so challenging on you and so on. You know? But I now feel inspired. So you fasten your seatbelt a little tighter. Yeah. Now, Pastor Morancy has an announcement he would like to make, and we did promise a special gift. So, Pastor Morancy, come on up. Let's do this so we can get ready for the sermon tonight. There's some things to be given, some greetings to be made. We want to welcome a number of persons, and Pastor Morancy is going to help me do this. Or rather, I'm going to assist him because all the stuff is here now. Yeah? So I am thinking to myself, Pastor Morancy, that we have some first-timers here tonight. Oh, yes. People who have come for the very first time. All right. So we will see how Pastor Morancy is going to do it, but we have a number of gifts here. Let me help spread them out. And we're going to let Pastor Morancy have his way with this issue here. And then we're going to come back to the word. Go ahead, Pastor.
Good night, everybody. It's a big night tonight, and it's just your night. So we want to ask, that's to our visitors, special friends. You are there for the first time. Could you please stand? If you are here for the first time, my ushers come quickly. Just stand, please. Just stand. And we want to give you a special gift. And I want you to come for it. Pastor, come, please. Come and shake the pastor's hand. Come, please, everybody, once you are here for the first time, put your hands together for them. AY leaders, get to the back, please. First timers, it's a big week. And that's how we start in. All right, we're doing well. Though you have never missed a night, you are a visitor, maybe baptized, but you have never missed a night. Just stand, please. Never missed a night. Just stand. All right. Whoa. All right. You never missed a night. And that's why you come, please. Come shake the evangelist's hand. Come. You have never missed a night. Come. Put your hands together for them. Tomorrow night, if you have missed three nights, but you have been there most of the nights, then that's your night. That's for tomorrow. All right. We are doing very, very well. Okay, final lap. The visitor with the most visitors tonight. Just stand, please. Uh-oh. Don't tell me I'm going back with my cake. Oh, boy. I love cakes. And it would be a joy to go home with it. That's yours, a visitor with the most visitors. Going once. People saying things that I'm not even hearing. Visitors. You want me to change now? Okay, those with visitors. Visitors with visitors stand.
The visitor who brought visitors.
Visitors who brought visitors. Stand. One. Okay, one person. Anybody else? All right. And how many? Four. And we said Sabbath. What we said Sabbath again? We said 10. And she has four. Church. You got to vote. You got to vote now. We have the cake, we have the Bible, and we have the top up. Well, we have to cut off the top up. We got to cut off something. Yeah, because we said 10. We have 4. All right. So let's vote, please. It's in your hands. That person will get the cake and also the Bible, but no top up. Okay, you want to vote? You want to vote? Okay. All in favor that we give our visitor the cake, the Bible, and the top up. Raise your hand. Let me see, please. We count in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 20 hands. All right. Put them down. All opposed. Raise your hands. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The eyes have it. Put your hands together for her. Please come. Come shake the evangelist's hands. We are happy to have you. And you'll tell us your name. And that four persons you have, we want to add them for next Sunday. This time we're increasing the top up. The same cake, not a Bible, because you have one. I'm just assuming you're going to win next week. All right. What's your name?
Kizzy.
And?
Ishan Binwa.
Hankin Binwa.
Put your hands together for them, please. And here's the Bible. And the ushers, one of you, please, take her name and telephone number. And by tomorrow, we will certainly add it to her phone. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Give Pastor Morancy a round of applause, please. And congratulations to everybody for the gifts that you have received. Praise team, let's come on up. And we shall invite everybody to stand as we sing our theme song tonight. I would like to remind all of Dominica that we are still here. We have not stopped preaching. And we are going to be here for some time to come. So those online and those here, take the message. Send the message out. We are still in town. And we are getting better and hotter and sweeter as the days go by. Praise the Lord. Lord, I come to you.
Lord, I come to you.
Let my heart be changed.
Renewed. Flowing from the grace that I found in you.
Come on, let's.
right?
Sing it tonight. And Lord, I've come
Lord,
to know.
I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be swept away. And I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on by the power of your love.
Lord, unveil my eyes.
Lord, unveil my eyes.
Let me see you
Let
face
me
to face.
See you face to face.
The knowledge of your
the
love.
Knowledge of your love. Lord, renew my mind
as
your will unfolds in my life,
in living every day
by the power of your love.
Come on and hold. Again tonight, oh God, one more time. And just for this one occasion, Lord, we ask for renewed strength, renewed vigor. And as your word is proclaimed tonight, may souls be touched, may men and women be saved, and may people make decisions to walk all the way with Jesus. This is our prayer in that same name. Amen. Let the church be seated. Elder Kwesi Gorin.
Good evening, evangelist.
How are you doing today?
Better than good.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So we're going to preach again tonight. And tonight's subject is what, everybody?
Frequently asked questions.
Or FAQ. Frequently asked questions. Are you hearing me well down there?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I want to make sure that you're hearing me, see? Now, I want to begin tonight by explaining what I've discovered about FAQ. I was told that it is an IT or internet abbreviation for frequently asked questions. A list of typically recurring questions that people often ask about a particular product or site on the internet and the answers that accompany those questions. Very often when you visit a website, you may read about the services that that website provides. But sometimes a question comes to your mind that you find is not answered initially by what you find on the website. What you may realize is that there are other people who visit the same website and naturally have the same types of questions. Those questions that occur to people often in this context are referred to as frequently asked questions. Questions such as, how do I return an item after I have bought it? How much should I pay for delivery? How do I open a new account? How do I create a segment? How do I add email addresses to an email list? So multiple things that you may have thought about and had questions concerning, other people have those same questions as well. Now tonight, I would like to answer the most frequently asked question in Scripture. And I would like you to follow me carefully as I lay a foundation for this question. Now watch this. I read a story many years ago about a rich merchant who lived in a place called Baghdad. Have you ever heard about it? And this rich merchant one day sent his servant into the city center to do the grocery shopping. As he was down there, he saw death standing in the marketplace. And he was afraid of death. Now, this story I am telling tonight is called an allegory. It's not true. It's not real. But it makes a very important point. And so the servant saw death standing up in the marketplace. And he was afraid of death. So he ran home to his master and said, "Master, master, I was in the city today to do the grocery shopping, and I saw death stand up in the marketplace. Master, I am afraid of death. Please lend me your white horse that I might ride to Samaria and escape death." The master lent him the horse, and he rode off toward the sunset. Later that evening, because the shopping had not been completed, the master went himself into the city of Baghdad. And guess what? He also saw death standing up in the marketplace. And he went over to death and he said, "Death, my servant was down here earlier today and you frightened him. Why did you frighten my servant so?" And death responded, "I did not mean to scare him. I was just surprised to see him in Baghdad because I know I have an appointment with him tonight in Samaria."
Mercy.
And the moral of the story is, you can run, but you cannot hide. If nobody has ever told you before, we are all going to die.
Oh, yes.
Except Jesus comes back and finds some of us alive. If he tarries, we all shall die. It makes sense, therefore, for us to prepare ourselves for death. Someone once said that the man who has not prepared for death has not prepared for life. And death is a reality that is brought to us by Scripture tonight. For the Bible tells us in Romans 6 and verse 23, everybody together with the reader, what does it say?
"For the wages of sin is death."
Read it again, everybody. The wages of sin is what?
Death.
Death comes to mankind because of sin. original sin committed by Adam and Eve, but also continuing sin committed by every one of us. And so the scripture says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die.
That's the word, preacher.
Are you still listening to me tonight?
Oh, yes.
But I thank God tonight that that is not the end of the story. My Bible says that God provided a means, a mechanism, by which men and women can escape death. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 declares the gift of God is what, everybody?
Eternal life.
How do we get it? We get it
through
Jesus Christ. And so because Adam brought sin into this world, and with sin he brought death, I thank God that through Jesus Christ we can have eternal life.
Hallelujah.
But that is the only mechanism for eternal life. There is no tablet. There is no vaccine. There is no medication. There is no therapy. There is nothing else that we can do but to lean on the arms of Jesus.
Oh, yes.
I wish I had somebody here tonight who understands what it means to lean on Jesus. Eternal life is a gift. We do not pay for a gift.
True.
A gift is something that is presented to us, not based on our merit, not based on our work patterns, but simply because somebody cares for us, somebody loves us, somebody appreciates us, and somebody gives us a gift. I thank God that salvation doesn't cost money.
Oh, yes.
The songwriter said, if salvation was a thing that money could buy,
oh, yes,
the rich would live. And the poor would die. But we thank the good Lord that it isn't so, for the rich and the poor together must score. Everyone, regardless of status or station, must be born again.
Oh, yes, preacher.
So there is no preference of rich people over poor people. We all have the same opportunity, the same chance, the same equality of status before God. And therefore, in my mind, when I look through scripture, a frequently asked question is, what must I do to be saved?
Yes, sir.
What must I do to get eternal life? I want to share with you four different answers tonight that come from the Bible. I think there are four. Number one, Paul's answer. Are you ready, reader?
Oh, yes, preacher.
What is Paul's answer to the frequently asked question? What must I do in order to be saved? In Acts chapter 16, we read a story about how Paul and Silas were arrested for preaching the gospel of Christ. And how they were put in prison. Let's pick up the story in verse 23. Everybody out loud with Brother Gorin, please. What does the Bible say?
And when they had laid many stripes upon them.
What does that mean? They beat them. Go ahead.
They cast them into prison.
Charging
the jailer to keep them safely.
And what happens in verse 24?
Who, having received such a charge.
What did the jailer do? Read it, everybody. Out loud. He did what?
Trust them into the inner prison.
Now they were in maximum security.
Yes, sir.
Is anybody hearing what I'm saying? They were not just in the general population. Okay. They were in maximum security. The Bible says that he trust them into the inner prison.
Yes, sir.
And did what else with them?
And made their feet fast in the stocks.
Chains on their feet. Chains on their arms. Locked in the innermost prison. Somebody was serious that Paul and Silas were not supposed to get out. Are you still with me tonight, Church of God?
For sure.
And then midnight came and those boys began to have a praise party going on up in there. I want to say to somebody who is experiencing midnight,
who is experiencing hardship, who is experiencing bankruptcy, who is experiencing sickness, who is experiencing depression, who is experiencing broken marriages. God will never, never leave you. In the darkest moments of your life, you can still trust Him.
Hallelujah.
Grandma used to sing a song, "Smile the clouds away. Night will turn to day. If you smile and smile and smile, you'll smile the clouds away. Pray the clouds away. Night will turn to day. If you pray and pray and pray, you'll pray the clouds away." And then she said, "Sing the clouds away. For night will turn to day. If you sing and smile and pray, you'll drive the clouds away."
Certainly, preacher.
Our ability to overcome the challenges in our life very often relates to our attitude towards the problem. You see, very often we magnify the problems, so the problems get bigger. But my Bible says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt His name together." If we place the emphasis on magnifying God, the problem gets smaller. So sing hallelujah anyhow.
Praise His name.
Never, never let life's burdens get you down. Let life's troubles come your way. Hold your head up high and say hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Anyhow. Is anybody feeling what I'm saying tonight?
Definitely.
Are you buying what I'm selling?
Oh, yes.
I've got my mind made up.
Made up.
And I won't turn back.
No turning back.
Because I'm going to see my Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Someday. Jesus, Jesus, how I'll trust Him. How I've proved Him. Over and over. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus. Oh, for grace to trust Him more. In the blackness and the deepest midnight of your challenge, the Apostle Paul and Silas are examples to us. What does the Bible say they did at midnight?
Paul and Silas prayed.
And did what?
Sang praises.
Oh man,
unto
I hear
God.
Them. Do you hear them, Pastor Tittle? I heard them saying, "Won't it be a time?
Come on, preacher.
When we get over
yonder,
sing and shout, dance all about. When we get over yonder."
Yes, sir.
I heard them singing, "My faith is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand." I heard them sing. More about Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Would I know more of His grace to others sure. More about Jesus. And when you thought they were tired and done, they started singing. Sing them over again to me. Wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see. Wonderful words of life. They sang their problems away.
Amen.
Now, it is not that the problem is gone, but it's that your attitude has changed.
Oh, yes.
Because some burdens are not going to leave you.
True.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? Some things are not in your control. It requires other people's choices. So the person who is trying to get somebody to fall in love with them or to stay in love with them or to marry them, I want to say to you tonight, that has nothing to do with you. That's that person's choice.
Yes, sir.
And sometimes what must happen is that my perspective must change.
Certainly.
I'm not stressing myself out about things I can't change. I've got the joy down in my heart. Don't let life stress you out. sing it to be, pray to be. But I want to show you tonight that it is not just a comfort to sing and to prayer. My God responds to praises. Doesn't the psalmist say he loves to dwell within the praises of his people?
Oh, yes.
He loves to hear them call upon his name. And he responds to prayer. My Bible says, a broken reed he will not despise. A smoking wick he will not out. For God is mighty to deliver and mighty to save. God will make a way somehow.
Hallelujah.
Professor Campbell Wiggins, an old-time Bajan, died some time ago now. But listen to me, church. I'm feeling it too. I know it's a little distracting, but we got to work with it. But hear me tonight, church. Hear me tonight, church. So here's the deal, right? Campbellton Wiggins said he was down New York many years ago wearing a sign on him, prayer changes things. Somebody walked up to the man and said, prayer changes things? How do you know that prayer changes things? To which the professor responded, I'm the thing. Prayer changed.
Oh, yes.
Are you understanding me? My circumstances may not change, but I may have to change.
Absolutely.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? I'm going to eat rice without peas. Peas without rice. But as long as I have something to put in my mouth and my belly, I'm going to give God praise. I don't want to be like the Joneses. I don't aspire to hang my hat higher than I can hang it. With what you've been given, the Bible says, learn to be content. Sometimes your problem does not need to go away. Your attitude needs to change.
Yes, sir.
And when your attitude changes, you will find out that there's no problem. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
For sure.
So Paul and Barnabas and Silas, they prayed and did what? Sang at midnight. They sang praises unto God.
Oh, yes.
Go ahead, Brother Gorin.
And the prisoners heard
them. Everybody in the prison heard them. Verse 26, what does it say?
And suddenly,
there was what?
A great earthquake.
A shaking and a rumbling. So that the
foundations of the prison were shaken.
Everybody continue out loud together.
And immediately,
what happened?
All the doors were opened.
And everyone's bands
were loosed, preacher.
Now, did you get that, church? When a Christian gets blessed by God, other people get the blessing.
Oh, yes.
Are you listening to what I'm saying as well?
Go ahead now.
God is a kind of God that will spare a city of thousands of people if they are only 10 righteous. Are you listening to me?
Oh, yes.
I'm saying that when God blesses his children, there are other blessings that ripple to people who you associate with.
Oh, yes.
And then they ask you, man, where do you get this power from? Where do you get this authority from? I am saying your blessing must become infectious and efficacious on the benefit of others. When you go to work, people must see the blessing of God in your life. They must see a smile on your face. They must begin to wonder, what keeps this man so well in control? And when they ask you, tell them there is no secret.
Come on.
What God can do.
Come on,
what he has done for others.
Praise his name.
He can do for you. Is anybody buying what I'm selling tonight?
Oh, yes, preacher.
Yeah, watch this, watch this, watch this. So everybody in the jail now, their bands are loose. There was a verse called 27, Brother Goring.
And the keeper of the prison.
The jailer.
Awakened out of his sleep.
Just like a jailer.
And seeing the prison doors open.
What did he do?
He drew out his sword.
He's a Roman guard.
Come on.
And the Roman guards were never allowed to live if a prisoner escaped. And so they knew it was better to kill themselves than to wait for their masters to take their lives. So he pulled his sword and would have killed himself. Yes. Isn't that what the Bible says?
Yes, sir.
Everybody together, know the last part.
Supposing that the prisoners had been fled.
He made some assumptions, but Paul cried out
with a loud voice.
And what did Paul say to him?
Do thyself no harm,
for
we are all here.
They told, they were having such a good time praising God that it didn't matter that the bands had fallen off and that the prison doors were open. I believe Paul and Silas now sang a new song. My chains are gone.
Oh, yes.
I've been set free.
Set free.
Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
My Lord, my Savior has ransomed me. But they didn't run out. They stayed in the prison because the prison became church.
Yes, sir.
They transformed the prison into church. And we have got to transform our ugly circumstances into beautiful circumstances.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening to what I'm saying? Man, when I start to dance and praise and prayer, I like to take my environment of praise with me. And on a Monday morning when I go to the bank, I don't know for Dominica, but the lines are longest on a Monday morning. Our government pays pensioners in Barbados on a Monday morning. And all those old age pension checks show up at the bank. Everybody who is broke from the weekend shows up on a Monday. And the lines are unforgiving. As I stand in the line, I hear people grumbling. Big bank, 13 spaces, 2 tellers.
Yes, sir. We know it.
That happens in Dominica too?
Oh, yes.
I thought that was only the Bajan experience.
Oh, no.
Huh? I don't see the same name banks here as there, so I thought maybe it was a little different.
Oh, same thing.
But it is a little the same.
Oh, yes.
You go to the bank on a Monday, you got to stand in long lines.
Long lines.
And everybody grumbling. And Hall comes in the bank and hear them grumbling. And I start a conversation. I said, how did you sleep last night? Did you rest well in Jesus? I slept like a lamb. I slept like a rock. And I begin to tell them, isn't it a beautiful day?
Yes,
your life, God is in your heart. And before we know it, we are at the front of the line.
Yes, sir.
Attitude.
Oh, yeah.
I refuse to grumble in the bank line. Find a conversation with somebody as
yes.
a Christian and bless them with a Bible passage. You will be surprised how soon you get your cash.
For sure.
Tiny, why stand up and grumble about something you can't change?
True. True.
Anybody hearing me tonight?
Loud and clear.
Change your environment. Change your circumstances. My Bible says sin must not have dominion over you. The devil is not in charge.
True.
Place God at the center of what you do and turn your prison house into a place of celebration.
Yes, sir.
All right, I'm going somewhere with this, but I'm going. Paul cried out, don't hurt yourself. We have not gone anywhere. We are having church. And by the way, you are invited.
Yes, sir.
Step right in and have a seat.
Have a seat.
The Bible says in verse 29, then
he called for a light.
Remember, this is the security guard. This is the jailer. This is the prison superintendent. Paul says, we're having church and you are invited. And then the Bible says he called for a
light.
Because those boys were singing in the dark.
Yes, sir.
It doesn't matter how dark they sing anyhow.
Sing anyhow.
Sing anyhow. And he came in trembling and fell down before Paul and he brought them out of the prison. And he addressed them with respect.
Oh, yes.
Sirs, what is the question, Brother Gory?
What must I do to be saved?
When people recognize that the anointing of God is on your head, and there's favor in your life, and you're being blessed, and everything you touch turned to gold, and you are getting success. Man, let me tell you something. I've been to a few schools, and I've read a few books, and every school I've been to, I have been a Seventh-day Adventist, and I've never studied on Sabbath, and I've had excellent grades.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Praise his name.
I went to the law school in Trinidad. I think some of y'all heard that, right? been to a few schools. This is the most recent one, so I'll tell this one. All of my friends who are not Adventists, they go out on Friday night. And they have party and they dance and they want to sleep. They come in on Monday morning with bags underneath their eyes. I had a good time.
Mercy.
That's how you look when you have a good time? Huh? I come in looking neat and trim.
Oh,
clothes
yeah.
Pressed, face clean. You understand what I'm saying? Well rested, well adjusted, full of life and vigor, ready to face the week. I had a good time. Bags underneath the eyes. You understand what I'm saying? Out all day at some fete Saturday. Out all night Friday night. And while they're out there, I'm sleeping. And when the grades come back, theirs are no better than mine.
Amen.
Lots of the time. Mine are better.
Oh, yes.
And I have not broken God's Sabbath to do it.
Hallelujah.
Let me tell some of your students up here something. All you do is waste plenty of time.
Yes, sir.
Watching TV.
Straight up.
Watching sports.
Yes.
On the phone. Texting your thumbs, building muscles.
Mercy.
You understand what I'm saying?
Oh, yes.
And then when it comes to Sabbath, then is when you want to study. We waste time during the week.
True.
We occupy ourselves with all kinds of things. If you are going to be a student who is successful, give God priority and use your time wisely. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 for us. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 for us.
Oh, yes.
The seventh is for Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Are you hearing me? Prioritize and work. Transform it, transform it. Where am I now? So Paul is asked the question, when people see how blessed you are, when they realize how free you are, when they realize how happy you are, when they realize that despite circumstances and darkness and midnight, you can still praise God, the natural question is, what do you know that I don't know?
True, true.
What must I do to get this?
Yes, sir.
You're hearing me? I'm not boasting, but I told you I've been married to the girl now for 30 years. And that is by no means easy. That is hard fought. That is deliberate. That is paying attention to what matters most in a person's life and leaning and trusting in the everlasting arms. If it had not been for the Lord on our side. Are you hearing me? We couldn't last 30 days. But every problem, every difficulty, every challenge, every argument, we eventually found the time to take it to the Lord in prayer.
Yes, sir.
When a person is sold out to God, God represents and stands up for him. And I thank God tonight for every blessing in my life. And I am hoping that somebody will see that blessing in my life and will ask me the natural question, how can I be like you? What must I do to be saved? I want to tell some Adventists up in here tonight that nobody is going to ask you because your face is too sour.
Lord have mercy.
Some of y'all up in here, do not get people approaching you asking for solutions to problems. You know why? Because they look at you and you can't solve your own.
Mercy.
Instead of you setting the example of the goodness of God, you are showing them that your religion and your God does not make any difference in your life. So why should I join what you do? And some of y'all up in here are not living right. Y'all heard me? Doing all kinds of things on the side. I told you before, stop it. You are making God's name. How do you say that? Papi Shaw. Ça bon? Good. I'm learning, Barry. The Bible says it's because of Christians that the name of God is blasphemed. We who call ourselves Jesus people have got to live what we preach. Now, nobody is perfect, and we make mistakes. But you must not be wicked. A mistake is all right, but wickedness is the problem. You can't be practicing evil, practicing sin, not speaking to people, backbiting and gossiping about people, undermining people, not giving an honest day's work. Come on, Adventists. We who preach high standards must live high standards.
Straight talk, preacher.
Are you hearing me tonight?
Yes, sir.
So the question is, what must I do to be saved? And listen to the answer. What does Paul say?
And they said, believe.
Wait a minute. Let's read this out loud slowly together. Do what?
And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
And what?
And thou shalt be saved.
It is as simple as that.
Yes, sir.
You know, there are people who tell me, and yesterday I was talking to a gentleman. He said to me, y'all are baptizing people too soon. He said to me, people should be in some type of study class. And they should probably study for a few months before you baptize them. So I pointed out to him what I am going to point out to you tonight. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Well, first of all, let me be logical, and then let me be theological. So I'm going to be logical first.
Yes, sir.
Most people I know who go to a Bible class attend that Bible class one session per week.
True.
It means, therefore, that they attend four sessions per month.
True.
In 3 months, they attend 12 sessions.
12 sessions, preacher.
Since the 20th of March.
Oh, yes.
I have preached more than 12 sessions.
For sure. Oh, yes.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Clearly.
You get what it takes you 3 months to get in 2 weeks.
Amen.
Don't play foolish with me now.
Okay, now.
Don't we go online and take intense courses?
Oh, yes.
Aren't people reading for degrees that used to be 3 years now in a year and a half?
All the time.
Does it matter how long?
No, sir.
Or as long as you get the information and the content?
Oh, yes.
Now, that is me being logical.
Come on now.
Now, let all be theological.
Theological, okay.
The Bible says, if you believe.
Oh, yes.
End of story.
That's it. Straight shooting, Pastor.
Are you hearing me tonight?
Oh, yes.
We don't need a lot of long talk.
No, sir.
That's a Bajan expression that would have made Bajans go crazy in here. No lot of long talk.
Parley, parley.
Uh-huh. We don't need all of this. Let me tell you something. The Bible said, when they asked Paul, what do I have to do? Paul says, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you would be saved.
Yes, sir.
End of story. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Oh, yes, preacher.
That is Paul's answer to the question. Let's move on to another. You see, it's a frequently asked question. And I want to point out tonight that the person who saves us is Jesus Christ.
Yes, sir.
Did I mention that only Jesus can save us?
For sure.
Should I add on here that there is no other name?
Come on.
Under heaven or in earth or among men whereby we must be saved?
Yes, sir.
Now, you all understand what I'm not saying? Well, I'm going to have to say it tonight.
Say it, preacher.
This passage says, there is no salvation in anybody else other than Jesus.
Amen.
There are priests and bishops and obeymen.
Mercy.
And pastors.
Come on now.
And ministers of religion. who make people feel that their salvation is connected to who the leader is. My Bible says there's no other name among men.
Yes, sir.
Not Hall, not Tittle, not Joseph, not Moranzi, not the priest, not the bishop, not the pope.
Straight talk, preacher. Only Jesus.
This is what the Bible says. There is no other name.
Oh, yes.
Whereby people can be saved.
True.
So I want to say tonight, do not worship me.
True, true.
Do not worship me. 5'7".
Come on now.
165 pounds.
Tell us,
black,
preacher.
Short, intelligent Bayesian. But don't worship me.
True, preacher.
Heaven is not mine.
True.
It belongs to God. We get there through his son. There's no other mediator between God and man except Jesus. Don't pray to anybody else. Don't confess sins to anybody else. Only Jesus.
Yes, sir.
That's what the Bible says. That's what the Bible says. Praise the Lord. Acts 16:31. And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ.
And thou shalt be saved.
And thy
house.
Now what happens next? And he took them the same hour of the night.
And washed their stripes.
And was?
Washed their stripes.
And was?
Baptized.
He and his?
Household straight away.
Now I want to point out something. And I want to point it out to Seventh-day Adventists as well. How many sermons did this man listen to? One? It was a song service.
Oh, yes. Praise and worship.
How many Bible studies did this man listen to? And wait a while. How many did the family listen to?
None, preacher.
Is the point made?
For sure. Right.
Now watch this. Now Jesus also gave an answer to the question, what must I do to be saved? In Matthew 19:16, the Bible says that a rich young ruler came to Jesus and asked him a question. 19 and 16. What does it say, reader?
And behold, one came and said unto him,
what is the question?
Good master,
go ahead.
What good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?
Now, it's the same question, isn't it? Slightly differently worded, but it's the same question. What must I do to be saved?
Yes.
Listen to what Jesus said to him. Matthew 19:17. If thou wilt enter into life.
Yes.
Everybody out loud.
Keep the commandments.
Now, wait a while. The Apostle Paul says, believe.
Yes.
Jesus adds to that. Believe and keep the commandments.
Yes, sir.
Are you with me tonight?
Oh, yes.
I'm going somewhere. There are four answers in scripture. Keep the commandments. Now, in case you are wondering, what was Jesus talking about? Because there are preachers who tell us that Jesus abolished the commandments. Now, Jesus told the man, if he wants to get eternal life, keep the commandments. I didn't say that. Jesus said that.
Yes, sir.
And tonight you may be wondering, what did Jesus mean? Well, you don't have to wonder anymore. Verse 18 and 19, the same chapter. Matthew 19:18-19, Jesus said, he saith unto him, this is Jesus speaking. The man said to Jesus, which? Jesus responds and says, Brother Goring, what does he say?
Thou shalt do no murder.
Stop. Where does that statement come from? The 10.
Yes, sir.
What else did Jesus say?
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Where does that statement come from?
The 10 commandments, preacher.
And Jesus went on to say, don't steal.
True.
Don't lie. Do you see it there?
Yes.
It is true that he did not call all 10. But he is clearly referencing and sampling the Ten Commandments as the standard by which a person may enter into life.
That's the word, preacher.
Are you hearing what I'm saying tonight?
Yes.
Paul says, believe on Jesus. Jesus says, keep the commandments.
Yes, sir.
And he samples the ten tell us what he is referencing.
For sure.
Is that clear to everybody? Now watch this, watch this. The psalmist already told us the law of the Lord
is perfect.
Why would you want to abolish a perfect thing?
True.
All you saw the woman that I live in with tonight.
Come on, preacher.
Why would I want to get rid of her? Anybody listening to what I'm saying?
Oh, yes.
Why? You have something good.
Oh, yes.
Why?
That's the question. Why?
Why would you want to get rid of it? The Bible says, he that findeth a wife.
Find it a good thing?
You are a good thing.
Yes, sir.
In Jesus' name.
Come on, preacher.
She knows me. I'm no different when she ain't here than when she is here.
Yes, sir.
She knows me. The law of the Lord is what?
Perfect.
You don't abolish something that perfect. And then Matthew comes. Jesus comes in Matthew 5, 17 and 18 and says, do not think that I came to destroy the law
or the prophets.
Yes. I did not come to destroy, but to do what?
Fulfill.
Are you getting it tonight? Jesus goes on to continue to speak in verse 18. For assuredly I say to you, go on, Brother Gorin.
Till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle.
Not one tittle. Will by no means pass
from the law until all is fulfilled.
Until all is fulfilled. And in John, this same Jesus says, if you love me,
keep my commandments.
So the answer that Jesus gives is keep commandments.
Yes, sir.
Now watch this. James 2:10 says, for whosoever shall keep the whole law,
yes,
and yet offend in one point,
oh, yes,
is guilty of
all.
So we must keep
all of them. Yes, sir.
So far we had Paul's answer. We had Jesus' answer. Now we get Peter's answer.
Peter's answer.
Peter's answer to the frequently asked question. Men and brethren, on the day of Pentecost, when Peter preached, the people asked the question, now that you have preached to us, what must we do? What must we do? Men and brethren, what shall we do? It's the same question.
Yes.
What must we do to be saved? Peter says what?
Repent and be baptized.
Every one of you.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
For the remission of your
sins.
And you shall receive the gift of what?
The Holy Ghost.
Now, when a person repents, they leave their sinful life. To repent means that you are sorry for what you have done that is wrong. What are some of the things that the Bible says are wrong? Galatians 5 verse 19 to 21 tells us what is wrong. It calls these things the works of the flesh.
Yes, sir.
Let's read out loud together what the Bible says in Galatians 5, 19 to 21. Now the works of the flesh are
manifest.
Which are these? Read them out loud, everybody.
Adultery.
Uh-huh.
Fornication. Uncleanness.
Uh-huh.
Lasciviousness.
What else?
Idolatry.
What else?
Witchcraft.
What else?
Hatred.
What else?
Variance.
What else?
Emulations.
Wrath.
Strife.
Seditions.
Heresies.
Envying.
Murders.
Drunkenness.
Revelings.
Everybody knows what reveling is?
Oh, yes. C-O, preacher.
What is reveling?
C-O.
Is that a Creole word? Educate me. Bacchanal. What we call in Barbados, kuduman, crop over.
Yes.
What other countries call carnival?
Yes.
Reveling.
Revelings, yes.
Now, I am very often amazed at revelers. And I have never seen revelers in Dominica. I've seen them in my home country in Barbados. Decent people who work for the government.
Mercy, come on now. Talk to us.
And for private sector agencies.
Okay, now.
When it is not Juve or Carnival,
okay,
or Mardi Gras, these are all names around the Caribbean or Kadumant.
Yes, sir.
And you pass them on the street.
Okay.
They don't know you.
Okay, now. True, preacher, true.
They are very well dressed.
Oh, yes. I know, preacher.
Decent. Look, I'm talking about people I know in Barbados.
Okay. In Dominica, too. Uh-huh.
It happens here, too?
Oh, yes. Preacher.
So what happens next is when the Kadumant or the Cropover or the Carnival or the Juve comes, these people go out into the streets.
Okay.
In a bra and a panty.
Mercy. Keeping it real.
And they pay thousands of dollars for it.
Yes. Mercy.
And the only difference between what they wear normally and that is that it may come with feathers or glitter or, I don't know, sequins. But I am saying, normally well-dressed, decent people.
Yes.
Throw away all their decency.
True. Yes, sir.
That is what the Bible calls reveling.
Oh, yes.
Party spirit. Worldliness.
True, true.
And the Bible says, these are works of the flesh.
Yes.
Adultery. Let's read the list again.
Adultery,
fornication,
uncleanness,
go ahead,
lasciviousness,
go ahead,
idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders,
drunkenness,
reveling,
party spirit, and such like. Then listen to what the Apostle Paul says next. Paul is serious. Listen to what Paul says. Of which I tell you
before,
as I have also told you in time past,
that they which do such things
shall what?
Shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
Is that clear?
Crystal.
Now, in this passage, Paul says, I've told you this before.
Yes, sir.
So when I read the Bible and I see something like that, I ask myself, where did Paul say this before? Corinthians. It comes before Galatians. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Read it out loud together, everybody.
Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God?
Because they need to repent in order to get there, right?
Yes, yes, sir.
That's what he says. So go ahead now.
Be not deceived.
Neither
fornicators.
Nor
idolaters.
Nor
adulterers.
Nor
effeminate. Nor abusers of themselves with mankind.
Now stop there. When I read that, I wanted to know what that means. And I went to research this. What does it say, everybody? This is a list of persons and behaviors that Paul says will not get eternal life. No, I did not say this. Paul says this.
Yes, sir.
The Bible says this. And the Bible says fornicators.
Right.
People who have sex outside of marriage. Idolaters, people yes. who worship idols. Adulterers,
yes.
that is another sexual sin. Nor the effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind.
With mankind.
And everything I research said that that means homosexuality.
Yes, sir. Straight talk.
Are you listening to me tonight?
Yes, sir.
Because when I read it, I did not know what it was. I had to go and research that to find out what it means. And all of the reading I did said that this means homosexuality.
Yes, sir.
All right? The list continues. Nor thieves.
Nor the covetous.
Nor covetous.
Nor drunkards.
Nor drunkards.
Nor revilers.
No, this is not revelers this time.
Revilers.
This is revilers.
Yes.
All right? People who pay back grievances. People who fight back and are spiteful with their attitudes, nor extortioners, those are thieves,
true,
shall inherit
the kingdom of God.
So anybody who has any of these behaviors, in order to go to heaven, the Bible says we have to repent.
Repent, preacher.
And be baptized.
Baptized.
Now, I'm almost done. Paul says, and such were some of you.
Straight talk.
Man, listen, I'm no better than anybody else. Tittle, I am no better than anybody else. I am a sinner. I am a crooked stick trying to point out a straight path.
Come on now.
All of us have sinned. All of us have come short of the glory of God. But I'm a sinner.
Yes, sir.
Saved by God's grace.
Grace, preacher.
We all can experience that tonight. Paul says you have been washed.
Yes.
You have been sanctified.
Sanctified.
You are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. And by the Spirit of God, you can change.
Yes, sir.
Going back to Peter, they asked Peter, men and brethren, what must we do? Peter says, repent and be baptized. And then the verse in Acts continues by saying, then those who gladly received the word
were baptized.
All of you come to this tent and say to me, Pastor, you preach well. We like the word. We believe what you're saying. It's true. Many people have told me that. And I have constantly repeated to you that what I would like to see is not people being drawn to me or complimenting me. I would like to see people responding to the word.
Responding, preacher. Yes, sir.
Even if you do not respond to me, you may not like me, but it is the word of God that you have to respond to.
Amen. Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Do not let the word of God leave you because there's something about the messenger that you don't appreciate. When the postman brings a check, in Barbados, I don't know, the postman comes to your door. They ride a motorcycle, they put it in the letterbox outside your door. Sometimes they knock on the door and they hand it to you. When the postman brings me a check, and that check has $1,000 on it or whatever the case may be, do I tell the postman, keep it? I don't want it. Take it back. Simply because I do not like the postman.
Oh, no.
The word of God is the word of God.
Yes, sir.
And like a check, we must accept it. If God says it, and it's true, it does not matter which vessel he uses to tell you the truth.
Amen, preacher, amen.
And that day, about 3,000 souls.
Yes, sir.
How many sermons did these people hear? How many sermons did Peter preach on the day of Pentecost? One.
Oh, yes.
And that same day,
3,000
people said, baptize me.
Yes, sir.
Everybody in Dominica who hears the truth should be saying to the pastors here, baptize me.
Oh, yes.
We cannot do it tonight, but the baptism will be this Sabbath.
Yes, sir.
And you don't need any course. You don't need any 3 months or 6 months.
Oh, no.
These people heard one sermon.
Yes, sir.
Paul says, if you believe, you can be baptized. Jesus says, keep the commandments. Peter says, repent and be baptized. Baptism means to dip in water and to be immersed.
Yes.
When Jesus was baptized, he was baptized in the Jordan River.
Oh, yes.
The Bible says that when he came up out of the water, and I have been telling you, you can only come up out of if you went down into.
Oh, yes.
The Bible says that baptism should be by immersion.
Oh, yes.
Read that passage first, Brother Gorin, please.
He went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lightning on him.
All right. Now, Jesus told us what must happen before people are baptized. Let us read this. I'm soon to the end. Let us read this, what Jesus says. Jesus says to his disciples,
go therefore
and what?
And make disciples of all the nations.
That's what we are doing here, making disciples of the nations. Baptizing them in the name of
the Father
and of the
Son
and of the
Holy Spirit.
And then he says, after they're baptized,
teaching them
to observe
all things
that I have commanded you.
And lo, I am with you always.
Pause a while for me, where we're going. Haven't we been receiving teaching under this tent?
For sure.
Now, some of the teaching has not been easy to accept.
True.
Because you may not have heard it before. And when a person hears something new, it may become a little bit disturbing to them. It was the same for me when I heard it. But the truth is the truth.
Oh, yes.
The truth is the truth. Jesus says, teach them.
Yes, sir.
Teach them to observe all things that I've commanded you.
Yes.
And lo, I am with you always.
Oh, yes.
To the end of the world. For this reason, because the Bible says people must be taught, the Seventh-day Adventist Church do not baptize very young children.
True.
We baptize children who are old enough to understand what they're being taught. This author says children of 8, 10, or 12 years are old enough to be addressed on the subject of personal religion. Do not teach your children with reference to some future period when they shall be old enough to repent and believe the truth. Teach them now. If properly instructed, very young children may have a correct view of their state as sinners and of the way of salvation through Jesus Christ. Now the Bible says, whoever believes and is baptized, the same shall be saved.
Oh, yes.
I am skipping. The Apostle Paul was baptized by water immersion.
Yes, sir.
Water immersion represents the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus.
Yes.
That's what baptism represents. I am skipping. If you were baptized before and it was not done by a Bible method, it is okay to be baptized again. Tonight, I ask you the question, and now, why are you waiting? Arise.
Yes, sir.
And be baptized.
Oh, yes.
And wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Praise team, you can come. Musicians, you can come.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to end by telling you this story.
Oh, yes.
I do not know if this story is true. I read it in a book. It is supposed to be a story about something that happened in a Jewish family. And I like the story. But I must tell you, I don't know if this story is true. But I know it makes a good point. Are you listening to me? The story says that at the time, when God said to Moses, tell Pharaoh to let my people go. He said to Pharaoh, there will be plagues. And the last plague was the death of the firstborn child in every family. You remember that in the Bible, in the book of Exodus?
Oh, yes.
God had instructed Moses, kill a lamb. Let every family kill a lamb. And dip the hyssop, the branches of a tree, inside the blood. Sprinkle the blood on the doorposts of the house. And when the death angel passes by, he will see the blood. And the firstborn in that household will not die. The angel will pass over. Y'all remember that story?
Oh, yes, preacher.
The story says there was a little boy in that family. He was the firstborn child. And he had heard that if the blood was not applied, he would die. He said to his father, Daddy, has the blood been applied to the doorpost? The father, yes, said yes, my son. I asked Eliezer, my servant, to put it there this evening. The boy accepted his father's word, but as he went away, he was concerned. And he came back to see the father and said, Daddy, is the blood applied? The father said, yes. My servant Eliezer is faithful. He will not forget. The boy went away a third time. And sometime as it approached midnight, he got up from his bed, concerned, went to his father, woke him up. He says, Daddy, is the blood applied? The father said, yes, my son. Now go back to sleep. To which the boy replied, Daddy, show me the blood.
Come on, preacher.
They rushed to the door. And there was no blood. Father rushed out in the yard quickly. Took a lamb of choice. Sacrificed it. Just as the Lord had said. Collected the blood in the basin. And daubed the door lintel and the doorpost. Just as the death angel was passing over. Now that is a story I read in a book. And I don't know if it's true. I'm not going to come here and tell you anything that I don't know is true. And so I'm admitting, I don't know if this is true. But when I read it, it made an impact in my life.
Oh, yes.
Don't take chances. Make sure that the blood has been applied to your heart.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening to me tonight? It is the blood of Jesus that will never, never lose its power.
True, preacher.
It gives me strength from day to day.
Oh, yes.
And tonight I have shown you from the scripture that you cannot be saved except you believe, except you repent.
For sure.
Except you keep the commandments, except you be baptized. It is the blood of Jesus Christ that saves us.
Oh, yes.
Oh, who is willing tonight to accept that? If you're willing to accept Jesus, raise your hand tonight.
Oh, yes.
If you really mean it, stand with me, please. Stand with me. Praise the Lord.
The blood that Jesus,
as the song is being sung,
for me,
and you really mean it, you want to be saved, you are accepting salvation tonight. It doesn't matter if you've accepted it before. I'm calling everybody to accept again. Come on down. Come on down.
Reaches
love. Sing the song and come to the altar. God is calling on you to go the full distance. It does not matter if you are the only one. Jesus would have died. One. If tonight you want to say, Pastor, pray for me. I know I should be baptized. I know I should draw closer to Jesus. I am struggling. I am thinking about it, but I'm not sure yet. Perhaps you want to say, Pastor, pray for me. I have a problem that I need to solve. And I'm hoping I can get it solved before Sabbath. Or perhaps you want to say, Pastor, pray for me. I've said to my mother and my father, I want to be baptized, but they are not allowing me. Pastor, prayer that mommy's heart will be changed. Pastor, prayer that daddy will see it different. Pastor, prayer that my spouse will see it different. If you want to say tonight, I want to do it, but I'm struggling. I need special prayer. Remember, you don't need a long time. Show it to you in scripture tonight. You just need to believe, repent, accept Jesus. Be taught thereafter. Keep the commandments and live a right life. Is there one person here tonight who wants to raise their hand and say, Pastor, pray that prayer for me, please? Hallelujah. Is there anybody else? I see hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For you as well. Praise the Lord. Is there anybody else in the back tent? Is that you? If I mention your situation tonight, it's not because I know anything about you. I stand here and the Lord brings things to my mind and I say them. I speak for God. If I spoke about you tonight, it is not because I know anything about you. It's God talking to you. Do not hold back on him. Is anybody brave enough? I will pray for you. Is anybody brave enough to take my hand tonight and say, Pastor, I will give my life to Jesus? Give me your hand. Step up. Step up. Give Jesus your heart. It does not matter to me if it's only one. I will preach the same way every night. I will holler and bawl and carry on. It does not matter. Is there anybody else? you're taking a serious step tonight. You're sure? Come. I will not stand in the way of anybody. Come. Come. Lord, do something here. Is there anybody else? Is there anybody else who will take my hand tonight? The baptism is Sabbath. You are struggling. You want me to pray for you. You've raised your hand. I understand that. But is there anybody bold enough to step forward and say, Pastor, I have made that decision? It reaches. One more person. One more person for Jesus. It flows to the high, lowest valley. Hallelujah. Give me your hand. Give Jesus your heart. Hallelujah. Is there one more? Jesus is calling tonight. Is there somebody else in here? Sally, tell me about that blood
that gives me strength.
Gives me strength. Lift your hands up to heaven. There's no magic in this. We're just a symbol of reaching up to God tonight. There's no magic in this. We're just reaching to God. I'm praying, Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. It is so sweet. And it is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to take him at his word. Jesus, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. But right now, we need your power. We need your deliverance. We need your healing. We need your salvation. Lord, there are people here who have raised their hands saying that they're struggling. Lord, fight on their side. Wrestle on their behalf, oh God. Tear down every idol. Cast out every foe. Lord, save these people, I pray. Somebody is objecting to their decision. Lord, give them a clear path to follow you this Sabbath day. Lord, some child wants to step forward, but a parent is standing in the way. Lord, release your people tonight. Tell those who are standing in the way, let my people go. Lord, deliver somebody. Save somebody. We thank you. We thank you tonight. And grant that when this Sabbath day comes, they may step out. They may step out from the crowd and come to the altar crying, I yield. I can no longer hold out. We thank you for the blood. It was the blood of Jesus that saved me. Now we say, go in peace. For God the Father loves you. Go in peace, for God the Son died to save you. Go in peace, for God the Holy Spirit is in you and with you to guide you. Go there, church. In peace. Get home safely. God bless you. Thank you for viewing us online tonight. And please join us again tomorrow night when we'll have another important subject.
For the cross, Lord, thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Your cleansing flow. Now all I know, your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb,
sitting on the throne.
Sitting on the throne.
We crown you now.
We crown you now with many crowns.
Thank you.